I am Bernard Seguin from France. I am retired now, but I was working with the French INRA, that's to say in a National Institution for Agronomic Research. And my career was based on interaction between climate and agriculture. And from 10 years, about the influence of climate change on agriculture. So we can start with climate change and agriculture. And I shall start with two slides, more or less well known, but just to recall the projections on the global temperature. You have seen from Thomas Stoker, for instance, on the upside, and depending evidently upon the scenario, but we know that we will have a warmer Earth, in some regions warmer, in some regions less warmer. But the other point is that maybe more important for biosphere and vegetation in general and agriculture, the middle figure will be change in precipitation. So if you look at them, you will see, especially for the scenario right, the pessimistic scenario, a big contrast between blue zones where precipitation will increase and more or less yellow-brown areas where precipitation will diminish. So drier conditions, and you may see that it will... I shall try to put here. All around the Mediterranean area, all around the California, more or less Central America, all these zones here will suffer from more frequent and more severe droughts. So evidently, it's something which is very important for crops. Crops, you can give good temperature, you can give light and so on, good photosynthesis. If you have no water, you know that if you are cultivating flowers, they will die. So for the future, we will have to cope with these figures. And you may think that there will be very different consequences, impact, depending upon the regional zone you are considering. Another point will be the increase of extremes. I don't remember if Thomas showed this picture, but something which is not a surprise, the extreme hot conditions, which will be very more frequent, and also for vegetation, if you have temperatures more than 40 degrees, 45, even starting with 35, it could be something which exceeds the threshold and provoking the dying of the crop. And I already mentioned the drought conditions. So if you are looking at this figure here, with extreme dry, you will find the same zones where there are great probabilities of having more problems of severe drought in the future. Okay, so just a figure here, and maybe it will be the main message here from this sketch showing that the functions of plants and vegetation in general with exchanges of water vapor, CO2 and so on, and taking the elements in the soil and also water vapor. If we are looking at the possible impact on different parts of the system and the elementary functions, physiological functions. The first thing here, it has nothing to do here with climate change, in fact, but with CO2 increasing. And already Laurent Bopp yesterday mentioned the fertilization with CO2. It's something which could be important for vegetation and crops in particular. We will see just after the order of magnitude. We speak about fertilization. We may also more joke about doping, in terms of sport, doping with CO2. We can say that CO2 is the EPO of plants in the future. I mentioned that there will be changes in temperature and rainfall. We will not speak about other climatic variables like solar radiation, for instance, evidently very important for photosynthesis, but also for transpiration. We will not speak about wind velocity. We will not speak about humidity. But all these elements will also play on the consequences, not at the same level as temperature and rainfall, but for a complete assessment of impacts, we will need to have the projections about these elements. Okay, now if we look at here, we have a doping, a positive effect if we consider the yield of a biomass production and, because of CO2. If we are looking at temperature and rainfall, in general, the crops and plants are adapted to a range of temperatures more or less near the optimum temperature. Sometimes you may add 1-2 degrees and it could be better. I'm thinking in Europe, for instance, in many regions, if you are able to give 1-2 degrees more to a farmer, he will pay for that. It's just before this level. But if you are giving more than 2 degrees, 3 degrees, 4 degrees, 5 degrees, you are beginning to go to the negative effect and thresholds and so on. So you can have positive in general effect here, but not always. Something also less known is about the cycle duration for crops. It's not the case for forest and permanent cultivation, not cultivation, vegetation. When you are cultivating wheat, for instance, or maize, with the increase of temperature, phenology will be advanced. Phenology is all the stages like flowering and so on. So everything will arrive quicker and the duration of the cycle will be reduced. And you have to think that during the cycle, the crop are functioning, are working to elaborate photosynthesis and so on. So if you are reducing the cycle, it will be a negative effect on production. So you have seen here positive, positive, negative. Okay. And for water vapor, it's very different. And you have to cope with the components, rainfall giving water, and potential evapotranspiration, which is the maximum level what climate imposes for crops having enough water. In general, this potential evapotranspiration will be increased in warmer temperatures. So sometimes in dry areas, you will have less rainfall and more demand from the climate. So your level of water stress will be increased. And in general, it's something negative. So about this water balance, and everything at the end is depending upon the nitrogen level in the soil, which has nothing to do with climate change, but will define the level of final production. So the message here is that you have a lot of different impacts. And so sometimes it could be positive, sometimes not very important, sometimes negative. So if you combine with the first thing you have seen, the final effect is that the effect on crops production yields will be very different upon regions and upon the type of crops you are considering. I just come back briefly with photosynthesis because it's important. It's a well-known thing, so a laboratory experiment known from 50 years when we thought at this time that everything was changing except CO2. Now we know that CO2 is also changing. And you can see here the consequences for photosynthesis when starting from usual levels to doubling of CO2. Doubling of CO2 for these C3 crops is able to increase the photosynthesis by 30%. So it's very important effect if everything is okay for the other elements. What are C3? Briefly, it's a kind of a photosynthesis cycle. It's more or less the temperate crops we know. And you can see that it's not the same thing for the C4, only 10%, and C4 and more or less the tropical crops. So the CO2 effect, the fertilization, the doping, will be less in tropical areas, in warm areas, as in temperate zone. And it's a first consequence, not because of climate change, but there will be a more advantage for northern countries or southern, less in the south, but than in warm areas. Okay, it's not an idea like that. You have seen with Laurent measurements with vegetation system with where you can put more CO2 in the field for forest and so on. If you are looking at wheat, for instance, there are results giving this effect of photosynthesis enhancement. And even for maize, which is not, I think maize is for English, and you ask me, I think in the United States it could be corn. I'm not sure, but okay, maize, you understand. And you will see here results giving an increase, less important, because it's a C4 crop. Phenology, it's fruit trees, for instance. It was the first thinking we had maybe 15 years ago when we started about questioning the possible consequences. You could have problems of mild winters. During winter, there is a dormancy, and you need cold periods for stopping the dormancy. And in mild winters, you may have problems. It's a reason for which, for instance, you cannot cultivate apricot in Tunisia. You have in the south of France, in Spain, and so on, not in Tunisia, because there is not enough cold period. And I think you will have the same thing for the south of the United States. And we have seen that some years, winters, we have seen problems of mild winters on this point. Flowers were not very good condition and were falling. The other point is the advance of phenology, which is more, I should say, more frequent about the risk of frost risk in spring, for instance. If you are speaking with only climatologists, they will say, okay, in warmer, and everybody will say, in warmer conditions, there are less risk of frost. But for fruit trees, for instance, frost is not only a temperature, minimum temperature, it's a coincidence with a stage of development. And if you are advancing the phenology, the time of flowering, for instance, maybe the effect could be opposite. We had some simulations for climate of Avignon, Mediterranean part of France, and we have seen that here there will be no change for April. It was in the past, recent periods, here recent period and past, and in the future, we have seen that there will be a risk of frost with apricot because of 1 month in advance in flowering time. And the same for peach on the right part. Okay, so another, just thinking like that was about consequences for wine, for instance. I have a lot of things with wine, but I shall not have time at the end, so only small points here. If you are looking at the cycle with bud burst, here, flowering, and the raison, it's a period when the grapes are turning color, are maturing, and the quality of wine is very dependent upon this period. You need, at this time, not too high temperature. If we look at this possible, it was simple computation, but now we have more detail and the same result here. The typical past calendar here, bud burst here, flowering here, and the raison, more or less middle of August and beginning of September. 2 degrees more, 4 degrees more. Okay, going directly to 4 degrees more, you advance flowering with risk of, we have seen with frost, and the very soon maturing period will occur starting beginning of July. Evidently, it's much more warm during July than in the end of August and so on. So there is a kind of loop with warmer climate, for instance, vine will advance and give the very soon period two times warmer, I should say, because of that. Okay, so it was a kind of well, some elements for specific trees, and after that, maybe from 10 years, there are more and more work with crop simulation models. It's a little like climate models. You put everything you know with equations and so on, and it's possible to simulate the effect of climate here on coping with also the type of soil and cultural practices for simulating production in terms of quantity and for some crops in terms of quality. So you integrate all of these points of microclimate because it depends upon the distance between the rows and so on, and the soil and so on. And everywhere in the world now, there are laboratories which have developed their own system of crop models, like for climate models in different laboratories. But we have now some integrated knowledge about the simulation for different crops and different zones. Here, it was 6 years ago, the result coming from the IPCC report, so in synthesis of the scientific literature. I don't know if you are able to, no, surely not, even with good eyes. Maize here, wheat here, mid to high latitudes, but more or less temperate zones. So if you look here, you start here, you see that for 1-2 degrees of temperature changing, incorporating the changes in precipitation, you add here up to 10% of increase, mostly using the CO2 fertilizations. And you see that when you are passing over 3, 4, 5 degrees, the advantage is lost, and we are going towards minus 20 and percent consequences. The other line here, when you are simulating adaptation, you can use other types of genotypes, you can change the dates of sowing and so on to adapt to these new conditions, because evidently in the future farmers will not cultivate the same practices as now. If you are simulating adaptation, you are able to increase the advantage towards 20% and more or less maintain even for warm temperature. It's for wheat. For maize, and partly because of the difference C3, C4, the advantage is less. And even with adaptation, we are approaching with zero and sometimes the negative effect. Here, low latitude, it's not to, an expression to say warm areas, tropical and so on. They still here maize and still here wheat. The figure is different. That's to say, starting now, even with 1, 2 degrees, 3 degrees, you will have a loss of production, and for 4, 5 degrees, it could be as far as high as 40%. And even with adaptation, you can more or less adapt, not too bad, until 3 degrees, but after you will have a lowering of yields in warm countries. And wheat, the same, and maybe more. You see here changes going up to minus 60%. And with adaptation, you are not able to totally suppress the negative effect of warm temperature or warming. It was in 2007. Also, one word with livestock and, for instance, pastures. So, always the same figure. That's to say, production will increase in humid temperate conditions up to 2 degrees after it will be diminishing, and decrease in any case in arid and semi-arid regions. The plant community structure will be modified, and there will be a change in forage quality and so on. We have also to cope with animals, with thermal stress, which reduce productivity. It affects the conception rates. It increases water requirements. A cow is able to drink in warm condition 50 liters per day, and so you need a lot of water, not only for humans, but also for animals. And so that generally you will have to think that at the final you will have a loss on livestock. So that global impact was given as blue, it's increased productivity here and in these zones, and decreased in more warm areas. There is something similar with forestry productions. So at this time, on the synthesis from IPCC, as a function of temperature increase, was for food with only 1-2 degrees possible rising yields in some high latitude regions, but already here developing regions will be affected by falling crop yields, and in any case when you are going towards more than 4 degrees warming, all the crops will have failing yields. Okay, I skip that. The final result with simulation from economists, for instance, on a global scale, confirm this kind of general information. And with all these colors here giving a reduced agricultural productivity, increased, and you see the contrast between all these countries here with increased productivity and all these countries here with decreased productivity. Here, if you don't take into account the carbon fertilization, because there are some doubts about on the long term the effect of fertilization, it's smaller, so sorry, but you will have the same kind of information with less negative effect and more positive effect here. But in any case, you have the large differences between all these regions, which will be winners, and all these regions here, more or less, losers in the future. I just look at... the scale of Europe, for instance, you may have this kind of figure for wheat yield. So you see that for northern conditions, you have increased yields. And starting from here, more or less, warmer conditions, reduced yield. So you have this kind of contrast in Europe between north and south, the same you have on the global scale for food production. You have this figure, which is an actualization of a past figure. It's more difficult to read, but you have the same thing between maize, wheat, and there is now rice, for temperate regions or tropical regions. But the same message is about the influence of 0-2 degrees, which can be positive for temperate regions here, and not with tropical areas. And after, you have a negative effect of climate warming. Okay, we have the same for wind. I skip here. Just to say something about adaptation. So you could have something with genetic material, and there is a beginning of work, depending upon the term, for instance, for annual crops, or maybe within 5 years there is a change. for wine or fruit trees, you need 30, 40 years for adaptation, the adjustment of cultural practices, and something which could be important, pests and diseases in a new climate could be increased. For pests, cryptogamic, there is more relation with humidity, so it's more diverse. But for insects, for instance, in general, warmer conditions are better for them. It's like for us. And the other part of adaptation, and I try to finish for having time for Carlo, it's about the geographical displacements, because evidently, if you are new conditions, there will be change in potentialities and so on. So in the case of France, for instance, just to give an idea, 1 kilometer is about 200 kilometers. France is 1,000 kilometers, so 5 degrees you will have in the north of France, the same condition as we have now in the Mediterranean condition. So you can think that the changes will be important and the same in any case. We have not seen many evolutions. We have seen, in terms of cultivation, shifting of cultivated crops. But for the future, with this order of magnitude, there will be changes in potentialities, maybe new crops, and so on. But it's not easy because you don't know which kind of new crops you can cultivate, because it depends upon your economical context. But there will be a specific question about terroir, which is a French name, but used for anybody for the cultivation of wine, where the adaptation to local conditions are very important. You can think that, for instance, grain maize cultivation, if you increase temperature by 2 degrees, for instance, it will be possible here, and with 5 degrees, you could cultivate grain maize up to the north of Finland. So it's something which we checked several times. It's true. So there will be a very important, huge change in cultivations all along the zones. But if you are going to give grain maize coming from Finland more than from Italy to cows, well, that will not. If you are giving wine cultivated in England or in Denmark instead of Bordeaux or Champagne or anything, even in Italy, well, it will be a different. So there will be a true question for terroir, and there are a lot of studies about that. It will be possible to cultivate wine in England. It's south, it's already the case. Even in the south of Sweden. So there is a big question about how the traditional wine producer will adapt, the same kind for California, Australia, and so on. They are beginning to move, cultivate on higher conditions, and a lot of research about changes in possible changes in varieties, but for instance, in Burgundy from 500 years, we have historical studies and so on. It was Pinot Noir, and we are not sure that Pinot Noir will be able to be cultivated within 50 years, and it could be a big economic question, social question, and so on. So I can end just saying that. I have no time also, but if you will look to the presentation, we have seen everywhere very clear already consequences more or less similar to what we can project in terms of, for instance, flowering dates, the advanced flowering dates for fruit trees by 15 days within the last 30 years. For wine, harvest dates, more or less 1 month, and the degree of alcohol has been increased by 2 degrees, the acidity has been decreased, so it's observed in France, it's observed in Italy, in Germany, and so things are changing. And when I spoke about the duration of cycle for maize, the duration of cycle in very warm years in 2003 was diminished by 30%. So 30% less time for working it's some kind of important. So in the opposite size, maybe 20% more with CO2 fertilization. Okay, so I finish and you see that there is no unique, it's not like sea level rise. Sea level rise is diverse, as we have seen in the world, but it's always a sea level rise. It's here, it could be negative, positive, winner, losers in terms of agriculture. And there are consequences, as we have seen, regional, local, and so on, but also for global food production. You know that we will be 9 billion of persons in 2050. Many studies about how to feed them, nourish them, and climate change is an important challenge with the impact we have seen on crop yields in temperate region, but also in already warm condition. And the, there is the general sense that less favored region will be still more less favored in the future. Okay, thanks.